what their ages are. Nope. And we're going right into picks and bans for game number two between Jin Air and Afrika Freaks. It's been a tough day for the Freaks, but we'll see if they can bring it together here. It's so weird to, that team name, man. I feel weird calling them the Freaks.
Well, the new name seems to have been hand in hand with their downfall as a team. The one thing you could guarantee about an Afrika Freaks game, or I guess a Rebels Anarchy game, was aggression. It was about making the crazy picks, looking for the big outplay. Instead, we just watched them literally get, I guess, strangled out of a game by Jin Air. They were never in it from about the first 3 minutes into the game, and they lost a slow, methodical 33-minute game. That's just not what we expect from Afrika. We need to see the outplay. We need to see the aggression. We need to see a crazy pick. Otherwise, Afrika's just going to find themselves 0-6 on the season.
I think you're right. I mean, I think they need to put Mickey on a champion that he can carry with.
How about like Zed and Twisted Fate? They sound pretty good.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think Jin Air is doing the right thing and banning those away from Mickey, too.
It's depressing that this is so effective against Afrika. Sungyun looked like he was taking that next step, but has largely regressed. Iksu, I don't think he has the champion pool to be a secondary carry. There's just no support act for Mickey. Not even Lyra can really make up or be a support act. It's Mickey only, and Mickey is finding 3 bans, 2 bans every game.
Yeah, it's looking pretty rough. What do you ban if you're Afrika? What do you take away? They haven't banned the Quint or the Graves. They left them open this game. It was a big priority in game number one, but after that Maokai pick, I think they're right. You really can't ban out traits right now.
Well, let's talk about a normal game between two teams. You'd be like, okay, the Victor was super effective. Mickey can play Victor. Let's take it away in this first side of the draft. The issue then is that you take Victor to buy time for someone else to carry, and I don't know who that's going to be. It has to be Mickey. So they can't even pick Victor.
I mean, you could argue that maybe Sungyun can get on something good. Like, you take the Corki here, the Lucian, perhaps, or the Kalista.
Kalista's been the champion shown the most on. Look, if you take Victor, maybe Lyra will come back. Because Lyra's a guy, you know, we saw his Gragas play early last season. I think Lyra's the sort of player who can play the jungle Graves, who can play a carry from the jungle. You need someone to put their carry pants on. Rek'Sai certainly wouldn't be an indication of that, but I'd actually look to Lyra as a secondary carry, but Afrika not doing that, at least in their first round of the draft.
Yeah. And we'll see what Wing decides to go with. The Elise pick, obviously very strong. And you can grab that Corki and then flex it, I suppose, too.
The jungler's available.
I like it. Kindred. No, Graves, I like that, too.
Oh, boy. Graves is available.
Speaking of flex picks, probably going to Trace, but we could play in the jungle.
Well, this is already exciting. The moment that we see Graves locked in, it'd be great.
Well, not exciting anymore.
The thing you can say is that you're pretty confident that Afrika will pick their top lane in the next rotation. They always save that counter pick for mid. So maybe it can still be the Graves in the next rotation.
Maybe. Maybe it'll just be the Lucian. Elise, Lucian, two very safe picks. You don't give away a huge amount. You don't give away huge much. I'm like inventing my own dialect at this point.
Huge much sounds like a British guy. Like Hugh Laurie.
Huge much. It's a
pip pip cheerio.
Yeah. Jolly good. Well, Elise, Lucian, you don't give away a lot.
Nope. Very solid picks. Alistar priority has gone all the way to first pick now.
Yep.
Lulu, of course, not being contested this draft. Definitely not an Afrika pick.
Ah, but Tahm Kench has slipped through the cracks so far.
It smells like a Corki mid, if you ask me.
Yeah.
Obviously a flex pick coming through. Are flexing their support too, so this is something different from Afrika. They are actually flexing some picks.
Yeah, now I'm getting interested. I'm kind of curious about
this. To be fair, the Corki's not really that flex when they already have a Kalista. So it would be cementing a Corki mid. Maybe they're scared of the Graves.
Well, I think counterpicking top may be the best answer here because Trace right now does provide the largest threat on Jin Air.
Well, let's see. They're giving an opportunity for Iksu to potentially pick a champion into a favorable matchup. Yeah. Whether he can actually take advantage of that and show us something different. I want him to shut down this narrative. Show me something special. Be that carry that Afrika needs. I'm just skeptical.
Papa Smithy wants you to be special. Isn't he special?
That's all I
enough
want.
Already?
He's in champions, so he's got that going for him.
It's true. Hard to do that.
Eva, of course, know that very well.
Yeah.
Sitting in the Challenge League.
I would love it if they took the Tahm Kench right here.
be a possibility.
Tom Kench, Cassiopeia seems reasonable. Fiora seems also reasonable. But, you know, if you take the Fiora, you know, like they're very, you know, very clearly showing, they're like, well, will they take the Tom Kench if we take the Fiora? I don't know. Then again, I mean, nobody's going to walk into a Cassiopeia ultimate like Tom Kench is going to, right?
Tom Kench makes the most amount of sense.
I like it.
In this draft. I'm really interested to see Kuzan opting into the Corki matchup as Cassiopeia in the early laning, pre-Rockets. I think Cassiopeia would do very well, but...
Graves.
Rockets come through.
Graves, please.
That's Graves.
Pick the Graves, I know.
You want it? You've run it that badly? Graves top.
This is the wrong champion that starts with GR.
Do you really
Let's go triple AD, man.
Do you really pick Graves top into Trace?
No, especially not into Tom Kench.
Actually, into Tom Kench was the matchup that Trace did so well on. Duke was playing the top lane. Tom
I
Kench. Push all day. Tom Kench has no wave clear. It is tricky to pick it against Trace because he's definitely going to be on the ball when it comes to rotations around top. Here's a champion now that Marin has left champions. We have seen very little of.
Yeah.
The Rumble.
See the Rumble. Thinking about it, really taking a long time with this last pick.
Ixu's the one who was given the opportunity to last pick. Maybe it's more about shutting down a pocket Trace pick than necessarily about giving a counter pick to top, but we will see the Rumble from Ixu. And honestly, this feels like the closest Ixu will get to a carry champ as far as we can see. Rumble and Lissandra, the most carry potential he's shown in his champion.
The team fights in this game are going to be really interesting because you're going to. I really wonder how they're going to use Corki's package and Rumble's ult together, because you can really cover a lot of a big area with Corki's package and the equalizer.
That's basically double equalizer. If you fight in a choke, you're taking, what, 300 magic damage a second conservatively?
I don't know the numbers, but you're taking a lot. Come on, you're asking me about numbers, dude?
It's a big one. That's all I can tell you. Corki has those too.
Yeah.
He's got a package, a big one. He's got everything.
That's like asking Bill Nye about UFC fighting.
How do you know that's not one of his hidden passions?
Well, I mean, he might be really into it. He might like it, but he can't do it himself.
He doesn't.
Probably wouldn't survive long in the octagon.
That's fair. That's fair.
Well, maybe he would, because nobody wants to hit Bill Nye. Everyone's like, wow, Bill Nye the science guy, you're awesome. I just want his autograph, dude. Maybe he would last in the octagon after all. Well, we'll see how long the Afrika Freaks last on Summoner's Rift. They were taken down pretty hard and pretty fast by Jhenair last game. A lot of work to do, but coming at it with a completely different comp. I like this, changing everything, trying something new. We'll see if it's enough.
After that game one, throw it out, try something new. I'm really excited to watch the mid lane matchup. Cassiopeia versus Corki could be an interesting one.
Yeah. Could be. Well, should be entertaining nonetheless. Let's get into game two. Jhenair versus Afrika Freaks. It's go time. Welcome back for perhaps the last time tonight to Summoner's Rift. Jhenair Green Wings going to be taking on the Afrika Freaks and looking for that 2-0. Looking to move up to 2-1, no, 3-1 overall on the season so far.
As I mentioned right at the tail end there, my big focus is on the mid lane matchup, specifically how Cassiopeia will deal with Corki post-6. Because pre-6, you can think of Corki trying to get in range with the Phosphorus Bomb, eating some poison, and then taking those big damage trades with the Twin Fangs. But when you have the Rocket to poke out every time Cassiopeia gets in, Cassiopeia, fiercely short-range champion against the massive range from the Corki Rockets, could be tricky for Kuzan. So the laning phase, as it develops, will be something I'll be keeping track of.
Well, Trace going back a little bit. Looks like there's going to be some jungle follow and no lane swaps. Whatever you say, Corki.
He's not bounding about like we saw yesterday from Fly, I think it was, in the Corki.
Well, I'm really curious to see how Afrika's going to play this one out, because last game was about as one side as getting. Look at this, Pilot and Che invading the Grom. Wow, really putting the aggression on. Can they actually make something happen with this? Just checking, I guess, but they went far.
And they weren't able to deny. They didn't leash far enough. Actually, it re-leashes.
Wow.
It was super low health as well.
The intimidation factor from Pilot and Che, I guess, were enough to cause problems for Sangin and Snowflower. That's kind of funny.
Still going to require the second group of minions to crash before level 2 will be acquired. So it'll be super interesting to see, actually, where a level 2 advantage comes in.
Yeah. Snowflower and Sangyun just wasting no time getting up in the face of the Jhin Air bot lane.
Shared experience. They were actually worried about Sangyun taking solo experience from the Grom because it would have pinged level 2 earlier. They didn't have that information, so they had to back away.
Here I was, hoping for a 2v2 fight at 2 minutes into the game.
Not your day, though.
I expect too much, don't
I? You do.
I do. Oh, well. Fairly normal lanes at this point, then.
Actually, really nice warding, level 1. Since so precious little invades for warding, but Jhin Air pushed a ward into the Krugs on the top side of the map, so we're confident to know that the lane swap hadn't been enacted and go and contest the Gromp. It did delay the Gromp, but obviously the reset, they still picked it up, still got some lane control.
You can see neither one of the supports having the best results on these champions yet this season, but the sample size, as we've said before, is pretty low. One of them is going to pick up a win. Che grab, he's going to take some poke. Take a lot of poke, actually. Nice flare from Snowflower, wow.
Headbutts to a minion, so that means he doesn't have sustain yet. Hasn't picked up a point in the triumphant roll.
I guess so. Good start in these early minutes for the Afrika Freaks, I suppose.
No real advantages taken yet. Actually pretty conservative jungle pathing in general from both junglers. No semblance of a gank. Freaks have had enough of bot lane.
Have they?
Well, I seem to. Went to go kill the Rift Coward.
Are they just setting something up for a dive, perhaps? I wonder.
Defensive ward over at the Krugs, so if Rek'Sai paths around there, we'll be spotted out. Yes, it is spotted.
Yeah, but Winged is way up in top. Looks like Lyra's just going to recall. And it's quiet on Summoner's Rift.
Crisis averted. No fights allowed. Back to farming.
Oh, good. Happy day.
Happiest of days.
Nice CS lead for Sangyun early on. They've been able to really bully Pilot and Che in this lane.
It's a reality of level 2 spikes. You always have to respect them. You end up losing CS and lane control. There will be a big minion wave pushing back, so that will be equalized. Speaking of equalizers.
Hello, Wing coming in right now. Iksu could be in trouble. Uses that flash early on. Iksu does some damage. Wing doesn't connect, though, with that cocoon, it looked like.
Winged held the cocoon. That was what he needed to do, but missed. It was actually a nice dodge, but poor accuracy from Winged. Should have been able to hit that. The Winged of last week, the one that put Bengi in the grave, really, you would have bet.
Well, he was hitting cocoons against Bengi that he wasn't even intending.
That's true.
Yeah, it doesn't get much better than that.
Finding the wild Eve in the brush.
But just a really nice path from Iksu to anticipate when Winged was going to try to lock him up.
Both sides of the pathing was good. Pathing from Wing to get there for that gank was smart. Rumble often overextends in lanes, which is famous to do.
Flash is used by both top laners too, so not a huge advantage. But interestingly enough, the TP advantage does go to Jhin Air for a little while at least.
Let's have a pseudo-global, at least a semi-global and getting to mid in the Abyssal Voyage, coming to him very soon.
That too.
A lot of farming going through for now. Corki actually already has the lane lead early. I expected this to start tipping at this point, the level 6 point, but for now it feels like Kuzan has been having to lose out on CS.
Yeah. Jhin Air having a bit of a slow start.
Snowflower going for the zoning lantern just to indicate that someone was bot. Nice little mind play.
Yep.
Otherwise, passive farming. Passive farming.
Oh, yes.
My kingdom for a grave, Stoa.
You really wanted to give your kingdom away a lot these days.
It's true.
Oh. Is there. Just protecting the recalls, it looks like. Maybe. Oh, Zongyun. Oh. I think they're going to try something. Yeah, they are. Oh, hello. Guess what? Thresh can see into brushes, guys.
Yep. No flash pole range there for Che. Had his flash up, but no such luck.
Yep.
Mickey going to start working towards Trinity Force. We've seen Trinity Force spikes for bot lane Corkies. Not really pan out, so we'll see if the mid lane Corki can take advantage of that and really start pushing in the mid lane. Should have it earlier, be higher level, so a lot of turret pressure coming soon.
At the same time, both of these junglers really being attentive to vision, going for the track tonight.
Speaking of vision, pink ward advantages with Jhin Air. If you can ever get double pinks up around the mid lane, then you have just such a stranglehold on the pathways around that mid lane, but right now you can see.
Yeah.
Bot side of the jungle, pink ward for Afrika, top side for Jhin Air.
Pretty much. But overall, a very, 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 very passive game.
Yep. Couldn't really hope for too much more when he saw the picks. No sight of the aggression from Trace. Winked. He was the only one that could really have broke the stalemate. Was a good gank path up top, but missed the cocoon and thus missed the chance for an early first blood.
Yeah, Corki's got the package. Let's see when he decides to use it. If and when.
Doesn't cost anything, but can open up so many aggressive plays. Only a week ago, the Faker was going crazy with the package in the first game of the season.
That Corki was spectacularly terrifying. And speaking of terrifying, Jhin Air's about to get dived pretty hard there. There's a package. They dodge it, but Pilot taking a lot of damage anyway. Doesn't get knocked up. No, he does. There's the exhaust. Can he get away? No, not with the flay. And first blood goes to a bloodthirsty Snowflower. That is a good start for the Afrika Freaks.
That's the Mickey we know and love. Very aggressive use of the package, but this is the same duo that SKT were running in that game one. Rek'Sai, Corki have so much synergy between the two, can really get in with the reliable engage, and it was just a nice rotation from Afrika.
Yeah, and they've already equalized all of their kills from game one, so they've got that going for them too.
Yeah, infinity more kills ahead. Zero in the first game.
One more and they could double their kills from game one.
Well,
and they've done this without giving up anything else across the map. You know, Trace is not able to use this to take a turret. Kuzan was not able to use this to get a lot more damage done on his turret. So really just very clean from Afrika. This is what they wanted to do in game one.
To be fair, we should walk back a statement there. They have obviously infinitely more kills than game one in percentage-wise, because zero times two.
Oh, yeah, that's right. I thought they had one kill last game.
Nope, none.
Not bad.
A massive bagel on the scoreboard.
Guess so.
Nice to see aggressive package play. We've actually seen a lot of Corkis really not get much going with what can be a game-changing passive.
Yep. Now, I wonder what's going to happen with this top lane, because Trace has been slowly but surely gaining a CS lead, and he's actually going to try for something here.
Oh, boy.
Okay, yeah, coming in from behind. It looks like they're going to try to catch Lyra, but
they are going on
no
quite the
such
walk.
Luck. Yeah, what in the world's going on?
This is the part where Freak is like, wait, what?
Yeah. All right, they're going to come from behind. Ixu has flash, though.
This is some creative pathing.
Yeah, no kidding. Ixu caught with the cocoon. Can they get him? One more from the time catch passive.
He missed clicks.
He did, I think. And Ixu still taken out, though. Trace, durable enough with that gray health.
Actually, what happens is that there is priority on the defensive. It's priority on eating your champion than eating the enemy. So that's why I didn't get it through.
Yeah, you got to be exact if your jungler is right next to you, or if any of the other teammates are right next to you.
Man, we've seen some interesting use of the Abyssal Voyage. That was quite the what. They got deep vision and a kill.
Yeah.
That was awesome.
That was, and it's going to let Trace do a lot of damage to this top lane turret, too.
Teleport is up from Ixu. We'll probably have to use it defensively. For now, though, walking back to lane doesn't want to give away a second kill under turret.
Yeah, I mean, it seems pretty easy for the Freaks to just dive that bottom lane right now.
At least they're sticking around. They're definitely thinking about it.
Yeah. No Krug for you. Trace doing a ton to that top lane, but Afrika Freaks doing a lot to that bottom lane. They should be able to get the turret. Looks like Jhin Air and Afrika will trade.
So use the equalizer to pick up the minion wave at minimum, but kill and also basic monopolization of vision on the top side of the jungle compared to just the reverse push given to Afrika. We'll take that if you're Jeanette.
Yeah, I would say so. And polite applause. Yes, it was quite a good turret taken. Oh, time for the Rift Herald to go down. Provide his buff.
Tell how strong or how respected Swiftness Boots are that even Rumble, the champion, of course, known about picking the double magic penetration items, will be going for the Swiftness Boots here.
Yeah, that's a good point. I'm honestly a little bit surprised to see that.
Just so, so powerful. It's so cheap as well.
So
800 gold.
I like it.
Trace doesn't. Actually has Abyssal Voyage up again. He's already gone for an impressive run for that ability.
Yeah, we haven't seen anyone consistently be very aggressive with the Tom Kench ultimate yet. But we may see that a little bit more in the future. He's just using it to get back to lane now.
Honestly, it's just nice to see someone use it basically off cooldown. You actually use that ability. So frequently we've seen players completely give it up. You know, I'll be on the other side of the map, so I have to teleport into fights and never really find the time to channel it. Creative things like going for the deep warding mission into having an excellent path to gank top. Afrika were very obviously completely confused by the maneuver, and it was super effective.
Yeah, very cool to see. That said, with that dragon lead, Afrika's looking okay. Trace, the one, the only. Jogging down the mid lane.
Tom Kench is a funny champ.
He's indeed. Looks like he's going to push that up a little bit for Kuzan.
Yeah, bringing his Rift Herald buff across the map, sharing it with everyone.
Yeah, why not? Doesn't really help the minions survive, but I think they want to just swap him over and get some more vision maybe in this jungle.
Yeah, just has no reason to be top lane. Could teleport back there if he needs be. Might have to swap turrets though overall.
Yeah, oh, Kuzan in big trouble. Snowflower coming in to help out Lyra. Che trying to save his mid laner, winged there as well. Lyra still chasing. Equalizer goes down. Wing zoned out on the outside of the fight a bit. Che on the run too. And Tom Kench saves his support. Looks like they may have to give up that blue buff after all. So no deaths, but a win certainly for the Afrika Freaks. And they can probably turn this into a turn too.
Two big misplays in that fight. Specifically, Kuzan actually whiffed completely on the petrifying gaze. Didn't get any stun. And it felt like Ixu was too quick on using the Equalizer.
Pilot's right here. Yeah, nice headbutt pulverizer. Flash pulverizer. Ixu thrown right back into lane. There's the exhaust. Is he going to get taken out? He will. Songyun with a kill there. But they lose Che at the same time. Songyun going for another one. Can he get Pilot? He can. A big double kill for the Freaks. Meanwhile, Mickey and Kuzan dueling in the jungle, but Kuzan really can't pursue this.
Kuzan zoned away.
Now
kill
Trace.
Trade goes really good for the Afrika Freaks.
It does. Trace needs to be careful here, too.
Still already pretty tanky, but multiple members of Afrika around.
Yeah.
It's a surprise, I think, from the side of Jhinne. They thought they had the pressure around the enemy red side jungle, but their own jungle very quickly collapsed by Afrika, and Kuzan not getting a register on that ult meant that just didn't have much pressure that fight from Jhinne.
Well, it's kind of surprising to see the games go so differently between game one and game two. Afrika looked hopeless in game one, and now they're really causing Jhinne a lot of trouble. Nice 2,000 gold lead for them here in just 15 minutes.
You can see when Afrika, when specifically Mickey has some lane pressure ahead in CS, made that successful roam down bot. Mickey is setting the pace of mid lane, and Afrika look comfortable in every lane as a result.
Yeah. Well, that mid lane turret, not a lot of health remaining on it. And as Pilot takes a red buff, Ixu sets up. I thought he was going to ward Dragon, but I guess he didn't. I bet they want to take that soon.
Even though they came to contest that first Grunt buff, look at the CS lead that Sungyun's been able to cultivate. 30 plus CS. Of course, it's met by the advantage that Tom Kench has in the top lane, but mid and bot definitely have won this lane, this game, sorry, in the early game at least for Afrika.
Right. Yeah.
Already a big pivot on last game where Sungyun was way behind for the majority of the game.
Yeah, no kidding. Now the question is, you know, Jhinne looked really solid closing that last game out. How are they at coming back?
See how the team fight phase looks, specifically if they can play around, as you mentioned, the devastating package and equalizer combo.
Yeah.
If Jhinne opt into fights and chokes, which remember, when you're contesting that enemy blue buff, they were basically forcing a fight in the choke. That's good terrain for Afrika to fight on. If they can recreate that multiple times, stay away from fighting in open spaces, like, for example, the mid lane. Terrain could help the Afrikos. Trace.
Ixu could be in trouble. Wink getting chased, but Trace coming from behind. Ixu behind enemy lines here. Kuzan coming up to try to intercept him. Dragon taken by the Afrika Freaks. So at least they've got that if they end up having to give up Ixu, which it looks like they will. Headbutt pulverize. Ixu not going to make it out of this one. Let's see who they give the kill to. It's going to go to Kuzan, but Mickey pushing this bot lane now.
Trinity Force Corki.
I don't know if that was really worth it.
Mid lane, Trinity Force Corki already level 12. This turret is exploding.
No kidding. The turret already gets taken out. And that's three turrets now. Two in the bot lane. For the Freaks.
Trinity Force Corki, double AD, and of course just got that extra damage to turrets from the second dragon buff. All of them coming together to some very quick structures from Afrika.
Yeah. Man. I would be very nervous right now if I was Jhinnir.
Trace is looking for the outscale, I guess. Gets to six items, then this Tahm Kench can definitely do a lot of work tanking up in the late game, but for now, see, both Mickey and Samyun doing massive damage to every other member of Jhinnir.
Well, Cassiopeia could do quite a bit, too, in the late game. I mean, Pilot's going to scale up. Do you feel like if Jhinnir just tries to stabilize, they can succeed in a really late game situation?
I'm worried about Cassiopeia in the late game. I actually always am, just because she needs to kind of fight in short range, and that range is going to be dictated by things like the equalizer, like potentially the package coming through. There's a lot of terrain denial that can come through from Afrika. So of course, if you get your zones, if you're able to free hit, the single target damage, especially from Cassiopeia, can be immense. But setting up winning team fights for Cassiopeia is often super hard to do. So far, Afrika have been smart about fighting around their win conditions, i.e. fighting in the corridors or the short expanses where equalizer can go across the whole team. More so than Jhinnir, that have played around Trace well, but it's been the rest of the map that's really let Jhinnir down.
Well, the big question now for Afrika Freaks is, can they close this game out cleanly? They've certainly struggled at any stage of the game, and honestly, this is the first game we've seen this season that they even have a chance to close out a game. So now we get to learn something new about this team.
And also, closing out is maybe a bit too generous at this point. They're ahead,
so?
But certainly not in a landslide fashion. One kill, a couple of thousand gold. They've rotated smarter, but they haven't really won a big team fight or got that big push to really give them the landslide advantage this game.
Too far away, though, it seems like.
Definitely building smartly, but still early days, I think, mostly. I like what they're doing also here. They're rotating around the Tahm Kench. He might be big. He's very, very tanky.
Yeah, but he's not infinitely tanky. Here comes Che. Wow, Flash Pulverize. Snowflower taking turret hits. They don't clear enough of the wave, though. Kuzan coming from the side. This could end up being good for Jhinnir. They're thinking about it. No, Kuzan a little bit too timid to go in on that one. Goodbye, Rift Herald.
But it's actually really smart from
winged.
A lot of damage.
Yeah.
It's smart to rotate around the Tahm Kench. If Tahm Kench is where he wants to be in team fights, absolutely can do a lot of work. But wave clear is not the name of his game. Multiple members hitting down his turret means the Tahm Kench has to just watch, and it isolated Mickey to take an unanswered mid lane turret.
Yep, going right back to lane now. So they do keep the turret alive for the moment.
Flashing health. Four turrets down, soon to be a fifth.
Yep.
Virginia.
Jhinnir just trying to hold on. Oh, Trace is right there. Oh. Tried to grab Sangyun, but no such luck.
Even though Ixu's been obviously having a hard time of it, three deaths already in 20 minutes, he's got the Liandry's. He's still going to be relevant. The reason why Rumble can overextend in lane, get caught, but still come back with a big equalizer. So Ixu's not irrelevant. And if they keep rotating around Trace, ensuring that there's never that 1v1 matchup where clearly he's going to be in the ascendancy, it minimizes any potential issues cross-map for Afrika.
Yeah. I just wonder what's going to happen once Trace gets tanky. It's not going to be too long.
Or when teleport plays come up where they have to send multiple members to answer Trace, because it doesn't feel like Ixu's ever really going to be in a spot to 1v1 him in a side lane.
Probably not.
Keep applying the pressure. Items are good here, similar to how Jhinnir had the important item spikes last game. Samyun has the Blade of the Ruined King, the Hurricane. They're definitely team fight ready. They've taken the easy turrets. It's, can they cultivate these harder objectives to take? Specifically, can they break the base?
Yeah.
fighting around an objective. Specifically, Dragon should be the easy objective, but fighting around both Baron and Dragon, as Lyra takes a little bit of damage, is the easy thing to do because they do not have the split bush advantage. The one thing Afrika doesn't have is they can't deal with the Tahm Kench in a side lane.
I suppose. Trey, speaking of, can't deal with Tahm Kench. Not taking a ton of damage. Flash, they're going to force a flash from Mickey. There's the exhaust. Is he going to get close enough anyway? Oh, he can't quite reach him. Oh, that was a close call for Mickey. Had to burn both of his summoners.
Exhaust actually coming up big there.
Yeah.
Cleanse and heal probably would have done the same thing, but.
Oh, it's fighting time. Snowflower gets pulled in with that Fate's Call. You really can't engage on that. Nice return onto Trace. Got to use that gray health to stay alive. Jhin'Air on the run. Trace in trouble. Goes down to the red from Songyu. Lyra tries to make something happen. Gets caught with the cocoon. Either way, though, this turret is not going to last.
Just like Faker on Lulu, Mickey's putting on map pressure. They're fighting smart. They're minimizing the effect of the big Tahm Kench. And Afrika playing a lot smarter this game. It took six, but they're finally looking pretty good.
Yeah, going for that Baron now. Oh, boy. They can do it fast, but is it risky?
Certainly is risky. They don't have the Trace teleport, though.
They do have Che's ultimate. They're going to turn on him. They're not going to finish off the Baron. That's big, actually. They were very close to taking that down. And this may cost them a mid turret, actually. Now everybody's a little bit low. Can they save their turret?
And see a replay. This is the fight up top. Trace was lucky that he could even pop the Grey Hell. Look at the CC chain right at the end. Just pops it early. Duke definitely would have tried to hold on to it there. But eventually rendered down. And good pick on the most fed member. Could have almost got pilot as well. But smart team fire from Afrika.
Now, this did not work out for Afrika at all. They took a lot of damage. They gave up their mid turret. Now it looks like they're going to give up Dragon as well. So much for that fifth Dragon stack in a timely time.
Timely fashion.
Yeah, sure. Jhin'Air really taking advantage of that mistake from Afrika. And it's mistakes like that really make this game still pretty close.
It was an endearing part of this team when they first came to this league. They were very good at some things, but obviously didn't have the finesse, didn't have the macro play that some other teams did. But now, 6 months into their lives, it feels like they really need to be ironing up some of those more obvious mistakes.
Yeah. I would say so. Jhin'Air manages to defend that turret for the moment.
Their wave clear, though, certainly not massive.
Not great. Che didn't even need to use his ult. They scared the freaks off Baron.
Only pilot really has a way to ranged wave clear. Of course, the big disadvantage of this Cassiopeia pick is that it doesn't offer much when Mickey specifically is poking around these inner turrets.
Yeah. They really want this mid lane tier 2. Can Jhin'Air fight this?
Still haven't got an auto with
Snowflower.
Haven't got any orders on it, so it stays at the same health.
You know, if Trace connects with one of his Qs, maybe they can turn it into something.
If he had flash up, maybe, but with no flash, going to be hard to get an easy pick.
Yeah. Got to be careful of Kuzan's flash ult.
Freak it back away.
Yeah. Good defense by Jhin'Air. And you have to wonder, is this maybe the time where the tides start to turn?
If this gold lead stays at this point or starts to close, then maybe we can start entertaining that. Afrika did play out a clean first 20 minutes, but as you mentioned, they were lost in the objective swap in the last round of skirmishes. And for now, they've not been able to expand their lead at all.
And one big thing is in mid and AD carry, just massive CS leads. 60 CS ahead for Songyun over Pilot.
I was skeptical about the Cassio and Tkorki, and certainly hasn't impressed me in practice either.
Yeah. It's not as far behind as he could be. No deaths, at least. But right now, Pilot just not doing the damage that they need him to do.
Afrika again, looking around Baron. They have excellent secure with the Kalista.
True. Jhin'Air knows what's up, though.
Oh, boy.
Wow, that's a very sneaky Baron for Afrika. They're going for it. Snowflower coming in, too. Jhin'Air knows what's up. They're going to have to turn. Afrika could be in trouble. Teleport coming in from Tahm Kench. No, canceled. Decides to just walk up.
Now he does have the ability to Abyssal Voyage in, so it's not quite the same as other champions in that regard.
That was good enough, I guess, for them to stop the Baron.
Do cancel the teleport. Can Ixu take advantage of that is the question.
Maybe. Could be. It's tougher with Abyssal Voyage, but it's definitely possible.
And the big issue is that in an off lane, Iksu can't wave clear in front of the Time Kench. We'll be chased down. May not be killed, but we are on very low health, even if he manages to escape. They just don't have that strategic advantage to be able to take advantage of, even though he's been able to wrestle back some of the CS lead that Tracer put together. Crazy how, from that contest at Grom, Sungyun was able to cultivate such a big CS advantage over Lucian. Lucian's actually a really good pick, laning-wise, into the Callisto.
Yeah. Yeah, that little scouting mission didn't work out.
That time's the charm.
Yeah, they're going for it. Now there is no teleport for Trace to get there. He has to get close enough to Abyssal Voyage in. There's a TP for Iksu. They're going for it. They're committed. Wing comes in.
Oh, boy.
Where's the cocoon? That Baron's doing a lot of damage. Snowflower on his own. Could be in trouble. Chain Kuzan on the side of the fight. Lyra tries to get onto Kuzan. They all go onto Kuzan, and that is big trouble for Jhin Air as Sungyun gets a kill on the mid laner. Trace on the run. Che way too low to do anything, and Jhin Air just has to back off. They prevented the Baron for the moment. They're too low to do it now. They prevented the Baron, but Kuzan got taken out. Got a little bit too close, but you have to. Whoa, they're going for it again.
It's really risky. They only have Rek'Sai to tank
that
this.
Is so risky. Rek'Sai is really low. Oh, I don't know about this, man. I don't know about this. Sungyun gets the Baron, but now they have to escape. I guess they can. Sungyun, the hero here, chasing Jhin Air away almost single-handedly. Pilot can't do anything.
Isn't it great to show confidence in your AD carry? I mentioned that his Kalista play was picking up. They showed confidence in his secure on Kalista. Get the objective, peel off, don't get any extra kills. Kuzan dies with flash and ult available. You gotta say, Cassiopeia pick is hurting them in more ways than one, because Mickey has had so much pressure this game that was completely absent in game one. We're seeing in the replay here. Kuzan caught, collapsed on by four people, can't ult, can't flash, dies first. That eventually leads to the Baron for a Frieza.
And you gotta wonder why Kuzan decided he needed to get that close. I mean, yeah, you're trying to throw poison into the Baron pit, but you have to be aware of that.
That's what you always have to do on Kassar. You always have to get that close because your range is 600. Basically, all your spells are within range of Abyssal Scepter's magic shred aura. He just he's either that or completely backing away. He tried to sow presence, instantly collapsed on. Good clear shot call from Afrika, when of course clear shot calling has been one of their big problems this season.
Yep. Now with that Baron buff, it's starting to look a little bit likely that Jhin Air can win this one.
Might be going to a game three, Doa.
Didn't expect it, especially after last game, but yeah, Jhin Air making some interesting decisions this game.
Not over yet,
bands.
But 10,000 gold, maybe.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't want to call it over either, but then Wink gets caught.
It's a lot of poke. They don't have any wave there. There's nothing Cassiopeia can do against Baron buff minions, but the siege not that great. It's only Mickey that has excellent siege. He's busy dealing with Trace in a side lane.
Suppose. If they can keep from losing inhibitor turrets through this Baron, that'll be pretty good.
The big one.
Wow, Pilot takes a big chunk there.
It's definitely good for Jhin Air. The most fed members just clearing waves slowly next to the best Sieger on the side of Jhin Air. Oh, the side of Afrika, sorry.
Yep. Oh, they've survived most of the Baron buff already.
Back away. Now you can see how important denying that fourth, that third dragon stack was
really
to Afrika. This would have been a fourth dragon, would have been a hard timer on the game, but only the third.
So Jhin Air still has a shot at this.
Gonna be very, very difficult. Gonna require, I think, a big positional misplay from Afrika to get back in the game.
Like a really epic flash ult from Kuzan or something, but... Oh, Trace finding himself caught, didn't see the Freak's coming at all, trying to waddle away. There's a cocoon on the Snowflower. Kuzan adds a bit of damage on, but I think they're just happy to get Trace out alive.
Yeah, lucky to get him out alive. No flash on Trace.
Yep.
Able to waddle away.
That's right. Baron buff is gone. They've managed to weather the storm a little bit anyway.
So need to set up a siege where Corki is grouped, because he's the only one realistically who can both zone with Phosphorus Bomb and Rockets and get those auto attacks in. Kalista, it's very, very risky to be trying to get auto attacks on to structures, so that's why, regardless of the lack of wave clear, it's been pretty much an impasse when it comes to sieging these inhibitor turrets.
Yeah.
Mickey's doing some crazy damage, but Trace shaking most of it off.
Well, Trace is the only one that's really tanking enough to stand up to this at this point. The pressure continues.
Yeah, it feels like a Jin Air game, though. Frickit doesn't know how to finish the game from here. No Baron available. Dragon down as well. Breaking the base, looking more than they can bite off right now.
Yeah, pulling back. They've got all the lanes pushed, though. Really good vision all over the place. So I think it still goes back to what you were saying earlier, where if Jin Air is going to win this, they really have to be able to capitalize on it. Some sort of big positional mistake by Efrika.
Worth noting that the 2016 minion changes do come into effect here. Specifically, bottom lane, there's a two-turret advantage, so the minions will be auto-pushing in. The big difference between this season and last season, that in last season, when you were this far ahead, you could still set up a freeze such that the enemy minions were so pushed up that Jin Air would never get access to the minions in bot, so they would just lose even more gold and be even that further behind when they eventually were forced into a fight around 5th Dragon, around the Baron. Because the minion waves push up, more guaranteed or close to guaranteed gold going over to Jin Air. Look, they're still far, far behind, but it just means that 12, 13,000 gold leads become 10, 9,000 gold leads.
Pretty much. Jin Air really on the ropes right now.
Those minions pushing in mean that if Frieka can't get a decisive advantage, a 5th Dragon, a Baron, there will be a stage in 10, 15 minutes' time where the gold lead is closer than it is right now.
Could be. It could be. Still at about 11k right now.
And again, you're relying on Efrika not pulling the trigger more so. It's more going to be a mistake on the side of Efrika than anything Jin Air can really force themselves.
I think, like we've talked about, the big story of this game is just the total domination of Mickey's Corki over Kuzan's Cassiopeia.
I mean, Sungyoon, great duo act as well to have that big CS advantage. Consistently been 50-plus CS ahead of Pilot.
Yep. Mickey nearly 100 ahead of Kuzan.
Flame Horizon's close.
It is, and you don't see that in the mid lane very often,
no,
do you?
No, it's in the mid lane especially, but you don't see low wave clear champions in mid lane much either.
True. Anymore. Well, Baron up in 50 seconds. I think that's when we're going to see some action.
Mickey get any autos?
Oh, Shay gets grabbed. Are they going to force out the ultimate? Not quite. Shay really, really wanting to save that one because he knows Baron is coming soon.
Baron 35 seconds away. The result of this is that, of course, Alistair will come back quickly with the home guards, but they won't be in position to get the sort of warding they want defensively around the Baron.
Yep. Yeah, they have to be really careful entering the jungle. We've had those shots of the vision on each team before, but I think it's pretty obvious who's got the better vision now.
Definitely. Genev's never been in a position to pick up neutral minions, let alone put down meaningful wards.
And Corki has the package.
Level 18, 0.6 items, only three, but obviously three very expensive items. 40% CDR achieved.
Well, I think he's perfectly fine with the amount of damage he's doing at the moment.
He's pretty buffed up right now.
Yep. All right, could be Baron time.
Pink Ward on the Baron, Pink Ward's defensively. Jinna have to poke to even get an idea of where Freak is at. They are spotted going for this move, though.
Oh, this is interesting.
They want to break the base again.
Going to top lane. And Jin Air doesn't really want to fight this. Efrika rushing down to this turret.
They have to fight instantly. They cannot watch as Corki rips through the turret.
Yeah, he's doing so much damage. Look at that. Turret gone. Equalizer used. And now Ixu's going to try to come in. No, he's going to get knocked out, actually. Che in the back lines. Pilot's got a good angle on this, as does Kuzan. A lot of damage dealt to Efrika here. If they can chase this safely, maybe they can turn it into something.
Fights where you're coming into a Cassiopeia should set up a big Petrifying Gaze. Again, we didn't see one.
Well, we saw Petrifying Gaze, but didn't quite create the results that Jin Air wanted.
This hasn't changed a team fight like that massive AoE stun can potentially do.
Yep.
They have to back away Efrika, and it does buy Jin Air time to at least get some defensive vision down and ensure that Baron's not as quickly picked up.
Afrika's all recalling right now. Jin Air, wonder if they're brave enough to try rushing a Baron.
Cassiopeia.
Don't think so.
Even when she's behind, does massive Baron damage, especially if she has a blue buff. But
well, it's too late now.
At minimum, they get some vision in the area that honestly they should have no right having, given how far they've been behind for the past 15 minutes. Maybe it'll have to be a fifth dragon game, Doa.
Maybe.
Fourth dragon respawn, so.
Fourth dragon being taken immediately. Jhin Air. Nothing they can do, I guess. Wow, Jhin Air kind of is rolling over and dying a bit at this point.
Well, this is not the fight they want to take. The fight around Baron is the one they want to take. The fight around fifth dragon. Feels like 43, 44 minutes. The latest that a Titanic fight will come through. Yep. From a Jhin Air perspective. You know, with this time to farm up, gold lead hasn't really extended. It's about 1,000 more than it was 5 minutes ago, so still very big, but not growing as much as it would have in previous seasons. Oh, Baron started.
And here we go. Yeah, they're going for it. Jhin Air, they have to scramble to catch this, but it's going down so fast already. Che, on his own, they turn off from it. So once again, they've been stopped from doing that Baron.
They do draw out Che's ultimate, and Ixu's split pushing.
Oh, wow. Ixu in trouble. Well, not in trouble. That turret in trouble. And now the Afrika Freaks once again trying this Baron out. Jhin Air uses the culling. Doesn't do a whole lot. Teleport coming in for both teams. They're going to try to catch Trace right away. Hook doesn't land. Kuzan has a chance here. He's got his ult, but no flash. And the Freaks are just going to go right back to the top lane again.
They really are respecting the petrifying gaze. They're not willing to pull the trigger despite being so far ahead. Sanghyun just soloing it down.
I guess so. Oh, gets spotted though.
Blue trinkets. Very, very hard to steal away these Barons when there's a good idea that it's going on.
Yeah. Oh, Kuzan gets grabbed. This could be bad. Snowflower coming in. Kuzan completely destroyed. And with that catch, it is not going to be a one game for Jhin Air. That is it. Afrika Freaks, all they need to do is just push down the mid lane. And there's not a lot that Jhin Air can do to stop this.
This barrier Cassiopeia from Kuzan certainly has not worked. It's caused Mickey to be so far ahead. He's been caught out multiple times. No ultimate. Nothing else coming through from the Cassiopeia.
Yep, 120 CS ahead at the end. And Jhin Air is going to try to mount a miracle defense here. Snowflower getting thrown in. Doesn't connect anyone. Trace grabs him. Might be able to get the kill there, but no, not even able to kill him.
The damage onto Pilot was insane from the Corki.
Yep. Damage onto the Nexus is going to be game-ending. Having a little fun with it. There goes the second Nexus turret. And that is it. We are going to game three between Jhin Air and the Afrika Freaks. GG.
Afrika Freaks, finally. Come up
first
with
win.
A more impressive performance. And Mickey, look, he had a good game, but